morning, church. How are you? Good. I have the honor and the privilege to lead us into the presence of God with this amazing start. How great He is. My name is Pastor Isaiah. I'm the church planter in Bridgeton, and I'm going to invite you to do something we have been doing this month, and it's to remember that through ages, throughout geography, Christians have come together and said, we believe this. And if we had the opportunity to travel somewhere else in Africa or in Asia and found a Christian, and you ask, what do you believe? They will say probably the same words. And if we had the chance to travel to the past or travel to the future, and you ask a Christian, what do you believe? They will say the same words. So I'm going to invite all the church together to say this aloud. What do we believe? And this is a proof that we are witnesses for what God has done in the past for us. So let's talk together out loud this Apostles' Creed. I believe in God, the Father Almighty, creator of heaven and earth. I believe in Jesus Christ, God's only Son, our Lord, who was conceived by the Holy Spirit, born of the Virgin Mary, suffered under Pontius Pilate, was crucified, died, and was buried. He descended to the death. On the third day, he rose again. He ascended into heaven. He is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again to judge the living and the dead. I believe in the Holy Spirit, the Holy Christian Church, the communion of saints, the forgiveness of sins, the resurrection of the body, and the life everlasting. Amen and amen.
Bless the Lord, O my soul. Strength. draws near and my time has come. Still my soul will sing your praise unending. 10,000 years and then forevermore. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul, worship His holy name. Sing like never before. O my soul, I'll worship Your holy name. Bless the Lord, O my soul. O my soul, worship His holy name. Alone. Father everlasting, the all-creating one, God Almighty. Through your Holy Spirit, conceiving Christ the Son, Jesus our Savior. I believe in God our Father, I believe in Christ the Son, I believe in the Holy Spirit, our God is three in one. I believe in the resurrection, that we will rise again.
That God has given you, all his provision, and how this is part of our worship to him. So I'm gonna go ahead and pray for these offerings. Last week we met one couple of missionaries, and part of this offering goes to spread the word. Some of those offerings goes to spread the world around us. So we're gonna pray that God will use these offerings for his glory and for our good. Jesus, you have provided us. You have given us what we need. Sometimes not what we want, but definitely what we need. Thank you for your faithful provision. Would you bless these offerings, God, and take them to fulfill your purposes? At the same time, we're being blessed by giving. Other people is being blessed by the proclamation of the word, by the witnessing of your works through these offerings. Would you bless this in Jesus' name? Amen. Mike, go ahead. Today's Communion Sunday. So I'm going to invite our treasure seekers to go ahead and enjoy today, because we want to see them really soon here for to take communion part with us. So treasure seekers can go to the back door where Angelo is. And while they go, I'm going to start letting you know what's going to happen. We have been talking about this, but guess what? It has been since right after summer that the pastor's team started to think about Christmas time. Can you believe that? We beat Walmart. It is true. We started thinking, what are we going to do? Of course, we know what to do. We know what to say about Christmas. But this is a time when the believers decided we will celebrate Jesus' birth. And this is a very special time for that reason. We are to remember what happened with Jesus. So in your bulletins, you will find an insert with all the Christmas activities. And this is, again, I don't want you guys to think like, oh, this is just a tradition. No, this is a time where this group of Christians in this time of the, on this age of the church decided to celebrate Jesus' birth. So it's a very special time. We are remembering what Jesus, what God did sending Jesus to our world. It's very important that we just get rid of the, oh, it's just a tradition. Yeah, kind of is a tradition, but the purpose of that is so special. So go ahead and open your bulletins. You can see, sign up, be ready, put apart, mark your calendars for all those Christmas activities we're going to do. On the other hand, before Christmas, and this is in November right now where we are, we want to encourage you to open your tables. And we've been talking about this as well. We want you guys to know each other. We want you to especially go towards those people that you don't know and open your tables. This is open table for November. We are trying to open everybody's house to somebody that you don't know, so they can, you guys can enjoy the fellowship of God in your own houses together with somebody else. So it's a very big encouragement. I want to challenge you. It's those conversations that are happening where lives are being transformed. Just as a side note, that is the strategy we have been following since we arrived. We are not going to the markets and the malls preaching the gospel out loud. We're inviting people over. And that's a very, very important part for our church to do. Invite people over to your house, especially those that you don't know yet. I want to invite Pastor Diego. Yes? Okay. There is a video, thank you. There is a video about that open table for November. Please pay attention. Lord, we don't need another mountain.
I think that was it. Well, good morning. Congratulations. You are the ones who did something with that clock. And so you made it. Let me pray for us as we get into God's Word. Father, thank you for your presence. Thank you that you are a God who has opened his table, his big table, to invite people like us from all backgrounds, from all ages, from all walks of life, because you love people and you want them found. So, Father, we ask that you will come and teach us as we consider this next value in the life of our church. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So Pastor Greg has been talking with us about vision. And those of you who have been tracking with us, you probably heard recently about biblical literacy being one of those significant values. Then 2 weeks ago, we heard about gospel conversations and the idea that God has designed us to be able to engage with one another and the people around us with this idea of the true gospel. So today, we are going to be focusing on the next value, which is the presence of God. The presence of God. And if you've been in our church for a while, you probably have heard that phrase quite a bit. So today we're going to spend some time around that value and linking that value to a specific aspect in the life of our church. So where does this value come from? This value of the presence of God can be tracked back to that day when Jesus was at the temple, and he was indignified when he saw that the temple that God had designed for specific purposes was being turned into something else. It's interesting what Jesus said that day. He said, and he was teaching them and saying to them, "It is not written, 'My house shall be called a house of prayer for all the nations,' but you have made it a den of robbers." Here we have Jesus in that picture. He is indignified because he's coming in, and what he's finding in the temple is not access, but rather obstacles to people experiencing the presence of God. And so he overturns the tables of the money changers. He overturns the seats of those who are selling pigeons for the sacrifices, and he is angry because his temple, his house, has become something else but a house of prayer for all the nations. So the presence of God, the value of the presence of God, can be transferred to this idea or this concept of the house of prayer for all nations. I want you to hear in that statement from Jesus that he's talking about certain kind of people and certain priority. A house of prayer for all peoples means everyone has access. It's not just for people who look alike, who speak alike, who walk alike, who does life alike. It's a house where there is access to everyone, irregardless of who they are or where they come from. That's why I love the concept of the open table, because the open table helps us to be intentional about looking around in our community and saying, who can I include? Who can I give access to God? Who can I give access to the presence of God? That's what the open table is about. Now, the other aspect of the house of prayer is that there is a priority. And the priority is that people from all backgrounds come together. They press into the presence of God through the venue of prayer. And as I survey this theme of prayer in the Word of God, I find that there is a personal dimension to prayer, right? We hear the teachings where even it is said to us that when you pray, go into that quiet room and in private, bring your requests before the God who hears, right? There's this personal aspect of prayer. But then there is this corporate aspect of prayer that we see in Mark 11, 17, where Jesus was indignified at the temple. So the personal dimension of prayer and the corporate dimension of prayer feed each other. That's an observation that I want to make. The personal dimension of prayer and the corporate dimension of prayer, they feed each other. You could say that when we individually recognize that we need to come before God asking for His help, for His wisdom, for His empowerment, we are more ready to come then corporately and do the same thing. But I would suspect that if we don't do that in our individual prayer life, we probably are not going to do that in our corporate prayer life. See, I think in our society, we need to come against this, the Jesus and me, that's all I need Christianity, that permeates today's Christianity. The idea that I can be a Christian alone. The Word of God confronts that. The Word of God presents a kind of Christianity that is not just personal, is not just individual, is not just for you and Jesus. The Word of God presents this idea that Christianity is something that happens between God the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit, me, and us. Let me say that again. The Word of God presents a form of Christianity that includes God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit, myself, and us. That is a biblical concept of Christianity. And so as we look about into this value of the presence of God becoming a house of prayer for all peoples, I want to tell you a story from the book of Acts, chapter 4. And I'm not going to read the whole story, but I want to kind of give you a little bit of an idea concerning this situation in Acts chapter 4, and then I will read a few of the verses. But you can feel free to also turn in your Bibles there. So here's the situation. We have these guys, Peter and John, two of the apostles. And Peter and John had just been used by God to bring the presence of God to this lame beggar. He's 40 plus years old, I think, according to the story. And this lame beggar receives the grace of God as these apostles come and look at him. I think the story says that, I think it was Peter that just gazed. They have seen this guy so many times, but this one day, they gaze at him. You know what gazing at someone means? I mean, they're looking at that person attentively. And this particular day, God is saying, I'm healing this guy. And so John and Peter become the conduits of a miracle. And they stretch out the hand, helped the lame beggar raise, and he's healed. And now he's at the temple giving praise to God for this miracle, and there is a lot of turmoil because the religious leaders, the elders of the city, everyone is paying attention. And they know that now the attention is on Jesus, because it is through the name of Jesus that this miracle has just taken place. So I'm picking up this story on verse 5. John and Peter are picked up by the authorities and they are put in jail. But because it's evening, they decide to wait until the morning to deal with these two fellows. So they're in jail. The next day, the rulers, the elders, and the teachers of the law met in Jerusalem. Annas, the high priest, was there, and so were Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and others of the high priest family. I mean, the big dogs are in the house, right? And they're gonna meet. They're going to confer this meeting. They're gonna say, what are we gonna do about these guys? So they had Peter and John brought before them and began to question them. By what power or what name did you do this? Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, said to them, rulers and elders of the people, if we are being called to account today for an act of kindness shown to a man who was lame and are being asked how he was healed, then know this, you and all the people of Israel, it is by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, whom you crucified, but whom God raised from the dead, that this man stands before you healed. So you can hear the passion of these guys. They're not shrinking back. They're answering according to the facts. They're saying, this Jesus whom you killed, and this Jesus whom God raised from the dead, it is in his name that this miracle has been performed. So the meeting continues, and when they realize that Peter and John, they were unschooled, ordinary men, they were astonished, and they took note that this man had been with Jesus. There is something about the way John and Peter are, act, speak, and do life that they took notice and say, these two have been with Jesus. It is pretty obvious that they have. So basically, they order them to leave the room. And then they compare notes and they basically say, we gotta ask these guys to stop talking or doing things in the name of Jesus. And so they threaten them, the story tells us. They threaten John and Peter, and kind of being concerned about the community who are recognizing that God has done this miracle and that it's been done in the name of Jesus, they basically send them out and release them from prison. So John and Peter go out, they leave the area, and they know that they are under the threats. And so they go to the prayer meeting where the rest of the believers are praying. And so I'm gonna pick up this story on verse 21. After further threats, they let them go. They could not decide how to punish them because all the people were praising God for what had happened. On their release, Peter and John went back to their own people and reported all the things that have happened. When they heard this is the very significant part. I want you to pay attention to the response of the other believers. When they heard this, they lifted their voices together to God and said, Sovereign Lord, they said, You made the heavens and the earth and the sea and everything in them. You spoke by the Holy Spirit through the mouth of your servant, our father David. Why do the nations rage and the peoples plot in vain? The kings and the earth rise up, and the rulers band together against the Lord and against his anointed one. Indeed, Herod and Pontius Pilate met together with the Gentiles and the people of Israel in this city to conspire against your holy servant Jesus, whom you anointed. They did what your power and will had decided beforehand should happen. Now, Lord, consider their threats and enable your servants to speak your word with great boldness. Stretch out your hand to heal and perform signs and wonders through the name of your holy servant Jesus. They pray. They were not concerned. If you notice, their prayers were not, Oh God, will you keep us safe? Oh God, would you change the political leaders of this city so that we can have freedom? Oh God, will you change the atmosphere around us? Oh God, would you not let anything bad happen to your servants, John and Peter and the disciples? Notice that they don't pray any of that. In a moment, we'll see what their prayers reveal. But I want you to notice that their response in the midst of their situation was to lift up their voices, to pray together, to be a house of prayer. And you almost can see that the undertone of their prayer is their concern for all peoples. Why are they praying what they're praying? Because they want others who have not come to know Jesus, come to know him. So let's look at what the prayer reveals. The first thing, their prayer reveals that they were telling themselves certain story. I like that. Their prayer reveals that they were telling themselves certain storyline. And I want to tell you this morning, all of us tell ourselves certain storyline when it comes to life and when it comes to prayer. Let me show you what their storyline sounded like. They address God as master, which means that they saw God as the center of life and saw themselves as having part within a larger story. They were living life with a larger vision. Can you see that? They're saying God is the creator of everything. The Holy Spirit speaks to humans to reveal the will of God. God fulfills his purposes through the godly and the ungodly. Do you ever tell yourself that storyline? Or do you tell yourself the story that says that God only can accomplish his purposes through the godly? These people were believing a storyline that says God fulfills his purposes through the godly and through the ungodly. They also were telling themselves the story that Jesus is God's anointed holy servant, that God is the judge. When they say, God, would you please take notice on their threats? But we're not going to be concerned about that. We're going to pray about this. They believe that God is the judge. And so with all peace in their hearts, they can say, God, would you please take notice of their threats? And they move on. They are telling themselves a different storyline. They're telling themselves a storyline that says, God can help, God can do the miraculous, and the Holy Spirit will empower us. So not only they are telling themselves a certain storyline, but as we saw, they are believing certain truths. And by the way, just a point of connection, that experience in that prayer room is nothing different than the experience in Acts chapter 2. On the day of Pentecost, where they are waiting for the presence of the promised Holy Spirit, and as they pray, they experience the presence of God, and they are empowered by God. So this group of people are telling themselves certain storyline, and they're believing certain truths, but they are also prioritizing the kingdom of God. The things they asked for were in keeping with the advancement of the kingdom of God. I said earlier, they were not praying about their safety. They were not praying about how inconvenienced they were being because of the threats and the way the leaders and the elders of the town were acting towards them. They're concerned about advancing the kingdom of God. So what are the outcomes? We see how this house of prayer, right, this gathering of prayer, where they're pursuing the presence of God. Let's look at the outcomes. After they pray, the place where they were meeting was shaken, and they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and spoken the word of God boldly. We can see that what they are asking for has been granted to them. What did they ask for? God, would you give us boldness to continue proclaiming your word? We'd rather obey you than obey the threats of our leaders, the restrictions of our leaders. And they receive exactly what they ask. They were given boldness, they were given the presence of the Holy Spirit, and they are going to continue seeking the advancement of the kingdom of God. See, when a church becomes a house of prayer, the church is empowered to proclaim and demonstrate boldly the gospel of Jesus Christ. And I want to tell you, when I hear our senior pastor, Greg, say that one of our values is being a people who are characterized by engaging others with gospel conversations, I gotta think, how is that gonna happen if we don't pray? If we are gonna be the people we heard from Leo last week, the international worker who came and encouraged us to consider the sheep around us who are not part of the sheep pen of Jesus yet, I gotta ask myself, how are we going to do that? How are we going to see that happening? And friends, Acts chapter 4 puts it right in our face and tells us, it's not going to happen unless we become a house of prayer for all peoples. It's not going to happen by our own efforts. It's not going to happen unless we seek the presence of God through prayer and ask Him to not only give us boldness, but to, at the same time, stretch out His hand to do signs and wonders. See, I believe we need both of those. We need to proclaim and demonstrate the gospel of Jesus Christ. But we also need God to stretch out His hand and do signs and wonders that show people that the kingdom of God is here and is real. Friends, we can talk all the Jesus we want to. We can do all the good deeds and acts of kindness that we want to. But if the world around us are not impacted and shocked by the revelation of a God who does signs and wonders, or even by the reality that the world will see something in us to say, it seems to me that you have been with Jesus, they're not going to be impacted. And so Acts chapter 4 takes us to that place. It takes us to the place where we recognize that unless we pray individually, corporately, we are not going to see the advancement of the kingdom of God. And so we're talking about a house of prayer. I want to give you some specific things. In a house of prayer, people pray together. In a house of prayer, people align their hearts with the will of God. In a house of prayer, people center their prayers on the advancements of God's kingdom. I'm with you. I'm on the same plane level. I have those days where, if I'm going to be honest, I live life from this little tiny vision. And what God wants for His church is to live life with a larger vision in mind. You know what I mean with a little vision in mind? What am I going to eat today? What am I going to wear today? What can I do to make sure that my kids are obedient? How am I going to produce the income that we need? What am I going to do to entertain myself? That's a very little vision for life. And what God wants to do is make us part of a larger vision for life. And so in the house of prayer, people pray on the advancement of God's kingdom. They also seek empowerment to be a blessing to the world around them. And so the house of prayer is accessible to all peoples. See, I think what Jesus had in mind concerning the temple back in the day is that the temple will be a house of prayer for all the nations. What that means is that He wanted that house, He wanted that temple to be an expression of the community. I am very thankful as a pastor, as a leader, to see that our church has some flavor to it. We've got different flavors here. We got some Puerto Rican flavor, some Italian flavor, some Dutch flavor, some German flavor, other Hispanic groups flavor. We have people who are Polish, who are from Ukraine, and many others, right? I'm thankful that we have some flavors here. Because Jesus longs for His temple, for His people, for His house of prayer to be an expression of the community. So house of prayer is accessible to all peoples. So you pray and go get your friends. Invite them to the open table. That's what we do. We pray. We say, God, who do you want us to bring in? Who do you want us to give access to? It's all about giving people who don't know Christ or have access to the presence of God access to Him. Access to Him. So, we want to pursue the presence of God. We want to become a house of prayer for all peoples. That's what we want. And I think that is so important. I like what Timothy Keller says. Prayer helps us reorder our loves. I think there is a reason that Jesus is insisting that we pray, that we become a house of prayer. I think God the Father knows that when we pray, our loves, what we love, what we treasure, what we value, is going to be reordered. But it's not going to be reordered unless we pray aligning our hearts with God, right? We can pray. But oftentimes what we pray is not, God, reorder my loves and my priorities. What we pray is, God, would you come and support my little kingdom? Would you come and do that? I'll be so happy if you did that today, God. So, here are where the obstacles are to become a house of prayer for all peoples. Number one, the story we tell ourselves. See, the story we tell ourselves goes something like this. I am the center of life. God exists to help me achieve my desires. Right? Those are sometimes the storylines that we tell ourselves. I think there was another one. Nope, not yet. We tell the storyline that says, I am the center of life, so I gotta ask God to support my little kingdom, my desires, my agenda. And that is a very small and distorted storyline. And that can be an obstacle. Why would we need to pray if we believe that storyline, right? Why would we need to pray? Because we're going to be confronted with what God wants. Someone said that when we pray according to the Lord's Prayer and say, Thy kingdom come, Thy will be done, what we are really saying is, I am ready to be obedient to your will. Why else would we ask God to bring his will and his kingdom to earth if I don't want to obey him? So the storyline that we tell ourselves when it comes to life and prayer can be an obstacle. Number two, the lies we believe. Here are some that I came up with. I know what is best for me. On any given day, how many times the storyline or the lie that we believe is, I know what is best for me, so I don't need to pray. I'll figure it out on my own. I'll come up with a plan. I will make it happen. That's how sometimes. Or, I can do this, I can handle this. Right? That's another lie. The church can do it without me. I don't need to go to that prayer meeting. The church can do it without me. I won't have much to contribute. And we believe that lie. And we relegate the responsibility, the call to participate, not only individually, but corporately in prayer to somebody else. The church can do it without me. The Holy Spirit is not for me. What I mean by that is sometimes we believe the lie that says, the Holy Spirit has not given me anything worth contributing to anybody else. Or the Holy Spirit has not gifted me in a way that I can be a blessing to other people. There is a word for that, baloney. That's not true. That's a lie. The Holy Spirit comes and resides on every believer, and He brings the life of Jesus inside of you. And He gives you gifts, and He empowers you. He wants to do this. And so when we believe the lie that the Holy Spirit is not for me, we allow that to be an obstacle. So the lies we believe. Number three, lack of self-control. You say, Diego, where in the world are you getting that? Well, First Peter, the same guy who God put in jail, is telling us. And I don't know about you, but I want to pay attention to what this guy is saying, because he lived through it. Even under the threats that were imposed on him, he said, I will pray for boldness and to be filled with the Holy Spirit and empowered by the Holy Spirit to do what they're asking me not to do, because this house is going to be a house of prayer for all peoples, and there are people who are not here yet whom God wants them to be found. That's the Peter who now says, be self-controlled and sober-minded for the sake of your prayers. Do you know, I know about the struggle with self-control. Yesterday, I was sitting in my living room, and on the one hand, I felt pulled with some anxious thoughts. I was finishing up some preparations for this morning, and I could feel anxiety pulling me in that direction. And then, at the same moment, there were some desires, there were some things that I wanted to do yesterday on my day off that I was realizing I wasn't going to be able to do. And my heart was being pulled. And I remember in that moment, as the two dogs were fighting, right? I said, stop. See, when we embrace self-control, we make space for priorities. That's beautiful. And the Apostle Peter is saying, one of the obstacles that gets in the way of individual prayer and corporate prayer and becoming a house of prayer for all the peoples is our lack of self-control. We don't have to spend too much time talking about just think about what our cell phones and tablets and computers and video games and so much access to so much entertainment does to us, right? It's going to take self-control, learning to stop, to pay attention to the Holy Spirit for the sake of our prayers. It's gonna take that. Until then, our lack of self-control is gonna keep us from being people who learn to make space so that we can hear the Holy Spirit and follow the Holy Spirit. The last one, which is an obstacle, is our lack of experience, right? It's natural to lack experience, right? We're not learned. We're not born knowing all these things. And if you're a new believer in Christ, you're gonna learn, okay? Our lack of experience, like Jesus said, like the disciples, they said to him, Lord, teach us to pray, just as John taught his disciples. Apparently, John the Baptist was teaching his disciples to pray. And so the disciples of Jesus are saying, we lack experience. Would you please teach us how to pray? So here's what I want us to do as the children are coming in, and we're going to get ready for communion. The worship team can come, and they're going to help us. I would like us to just set a tone in an environment here where we can reflect, where we can pray around communion. And so I'm going to put on the screen, if it works, right there. Just some questions. And I would like to give you a quiet moment. The worship team may be playing in the background, but I want to give you just some moment to reflect. You can pick one of those questions, two of those questions, and just quietly. Let's pause and let's make space for the Holy Spirit to speak to us. While we're reflecting, those who are going to serve communion can begin getting ready. As we prepare for communion, I want to emphasize the fact that communion points to an extravagant act Jesus offered to make possible the reconciliation of all peoples to God. It's extravagant. Very extravagant. Communion is both personal, but it's corporate. It's not just about us communing, relating to Jesus. But it's about us being part of a big family called the church. Communion tells us about a God who wants the whole universe to experience His glory. Communion confronts the life of any believer who wants to design and live for his own little kingdom. Communion says, no! There is a larger story, a larger kingdom for all peoples. Communion also reminds us that we are in process and that there is grace for each one of us. We're not there yet. And so as we partake communion, if you have placed your trust in Jesus, if you have considered the extravagant sacrifice of Jesus, and if He has revealed to you that apart from His name, you cannot be saved and reconciled and brought home and may be part of a bigger family, the family of God, you can partake communion. You can receive that extravagant expression of love for you. So I encourage you, when you're ready, come. There are four stations in the front, one in the back that I believe is the gluten-free station. And as you come, maybe you want to pray with someone. Maybe you want to pray with your family. Maybe you want to settle some accounts with God or respond to something He's speaking to you. So come when you're ready, and the worship team is going to help us continue seeking the presence of God.
Washed all my sins away.
Together as a church, and as we move into this fall / holiday season, open table season, a season to be mindful, a season to share, a season to be with family, to be with friends, a season to open our eyes and see what God is doing around us, a season to move from living life from a little vision to a larger vision that God has for us. I want us to pray as a church and ask God to come and help us, to come and do what He did in Acts chapter 4, to give us boldness, to fill us with the Holy Spirit so that we can have impact in our communities. So I'm gonna make room for maybe 3-4 of you to lift up your voice nice and loud and ask of God something along those lines. Would you do that? Would you just, right where you're at, just lift up your voice and ask God on our behalf. Go ahead. Father, I can sense your delight when we make space for you. And so we ask, would you come and reorder our loves? Would you come and fill us with your life, with your spirit? Would you give us boldness so that we love people around us well? Would you grant us success as we invite people to our tables? Would you open our eyes? Give us the gaze you gave John and Peter so that we can know whom to invite, so that we can know who you are working on. We will trust you. We will trust you. We want to be a house of prayer for all peoples. So come and help us. You are so worth knowing. Help us to know you, and help us to make you known to others. Thank you, Jesus. Isai is gonna come to kind of give you some practical suggestions, but before we do that, could we sing together something, James, that you feel led to lead us in?
Sure. Well, to continue in that theme of the amazing things that Jesus has done for us, this next song talks about the wonder of it all. So it's the wonder of the cross and the wonder of the goodness that he's done for us. Thank you.
Sunday to Sunday, dear little heaven, I come to see you. When will it be Sunday so I can see you again? Cielito Lindo is the name of that song. Back in the day, you didn't have a chance to see each other but once a week for a little period of time. And sometimes today we still do. This is not the case with God. This is not the case with God. We just don't get to see him once a week for a little bit of period of time. And then that's it. We long for next Sunday. Yes, we do. But we have the chance to see him every day and night, and be with him. So I want to ask for that slide with the practical steps that I want to encourage you to take home today. I want also to invite the prayer people, because we want to put in practice right now what we are telling. You can have the opportunity to come and pray with somebody here in the front. Don't pray about it. Do it. I'm going to explain this. Oh, I'm going to pray about praying. No, just go ahead and pray. Don't put it for later. Pray. Pray with others here at the altar. Pray. There is a gathering on Thursdays at 9:45 a.m. Come and pray. Pray with your discipleship group, with the people you meet in the week, with our pastorate, or in Celebrate Recovery on Tuesdays. There is an Encountering God Women Worship Night that is happening November 15th. Come and pray. There's a New Year's Eve worship. Come and pray. There's a College of Prayer in February. Come and pray. Don't do this on your own. Don't try this on your own. It doesn't work. Come and pray. For those that are ready to come and pray, you can come pray today here at the altar. For those that are ready also to go, and pray the rest of the week. I just want to say, I want to give you goodbye with this. It's a blessing. May the God, the Father, the Son, Jesus Christ, and the Holy Spirit be with you this week. And yes, see you next Sunday. But in the meantime, we'll meet in the heavenly realms praying. Amen.